FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz, and today is June 10th, 2020. Well, you know that investing nowadays is really a minefield, to say the least. God, you look what's happened in the market, a complete collapse, and then almost a complete recovery, all in a little more than 2 months. How does that happen? And how do you profit from it? How do you avoid the pitfalls? A lot of interesting questions here. Well, Kirk Chisholm is with us now. Kirk, you are host of Money Tree Investing podcast. You're highly rated and the number 7 most influential financial advisor in the U.S. according to Investopedia. And you've been at this 20 plus years. So we welcome you to the show. And for an average investor here who's managed to squirrel away some money over a 20-odd year career, saved, you know, stayed out of debt, and did all the wise things, what does that person do? How do you avoid all the pitfalls of what we've been going through the past 2 months?
Yeah, and thanks for having me on the show, Kerry. It's really a tough time for investors right now. And, you know, anybody who's been involved in the stock market has seen a huge change in the last few months. You know, we were already at peakish levels before the crisis hit. And then, you know, lo and behold, the market goes down, the S&P goes down like 35.5%, which is, you know, a huge hit for most people. And, it's challenging for people who are invested in the stock market because, you know, most people follow what I would call traditionally called as a modern portfolio theory approach, which is you buy a bunch of different assets, you diversify, you buy and hold, and then, you know, you basically buy and hold forever. That's kind of the philosophy. I don't necessarily buy that philosophy. I think it used to work. If you look back in this historically in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, that philosophy worked really well. But since right around 2006, 2007, it stopped working. And most people don't realize it stopped working, so they're still using the same strategy. So it becomes a little problematic because if you look in the last few years, you know, December of 18, the market dropped 20% in Q4. This year it dropped 35%. So, you know, the market is getting more volatile. The swings are getting bigger. They're happening quicker. So in December of 18, you had a whole quarter to prepare. This time you had a week, maybe not even, to prepare. Yeah. So it's getting a lot riskier for individual investors who are, especially investors who are getting ready for retirement, because the problem with retirement is you have a sort of a deadline, right? That you have to start taking money out, or you need to start taking money out because you're stopping working. So it's particularly dangerous to have a lot of exposure to the stock market when you're close to retirement. And I have to say, in the last few years, traditionally, somebody who's retiring might have a good amount of percentage in bonds, but because the stock market has been so crazy in the last few years, as in terms of crazy in the upside, I've seen a lot of financial advisors having 90% of their clients in equities.
Wow!
When these are people who are in retirement or close to retirement, I mean, that's beyond dangerous. That's, I don't say borderline criminal, but the system has forced people to do that because they don't have a choice. I mean, bonds are at 0%. So why would you invest in bonds? Just stick your money in the mattress or in a checking account because you're not getting any gain from it. So there's a lot of problems in the financial system right now. And getting back to your question of where people invest, we're big proponents of people investing in what they know. And what I find is, you know, if I talk to a real estate investor and that's what they know, why would they invest in the stock market? You know, invest in areas that you're an expert at. I particularly enjoy those kind of relationships the best, because it allows me to help that person invest better in what they're already doing.
Mm-hmm. So alternative investing, and because obviously in the stock market, you could be buying a company that you know nothing about and it could be blowing up the next minute, literally, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, the stock market is, it used to be a lot more logical, right? Like, you know, you could follow certain metrics, they would make sense. You could, you can pick stocks based on, you know, growth rates. And it's gotten to a point where I was having this conversation with somebody yesterday who said, well, you know, I'm a value investor and I want to invest in value stocks. I said, well, those have been out of favor for at least 10 years.
Yeah.
And it's not that that's a wrong philosophy. I'm actually a value investor kind of at my core, is I don't like overpaying just because other people are overpaying. And that is a way some people invest, right? It's momentum investing, as some people refer to. I'm more of a value investor where I want to find good values because there's lower risk. The problem is it's been out of favor in the last few years, in part because that's not what's moving the market. Everybody's investing in FANG stocks, and the FANG stocks are moving the market as a whole. So why would you invest in a slow growth value stock when you can make 30-40% in, you know, in a big tech company with seemingly very little risk? Now, I don't subscribe to that. I think it's kind of foolish thinking, but there comes a point where how many years can you do that before people fire you and just say, you know, you're not making us any money? Well, what's happened is it's forced people into indexing because they can't outperform the index unless they're basically investing in FANG stocks. That's kind of the summary version of what people are doing. So most people index because it's easier and they don't have to stock pick. But, you know, in times like this, in times of, you know, crisis, distress, or whatever you want to call it in the market, the markets operate almost the opposite of the way they should. I mean, look at what happened. The market went down 35%. I think we're 3% off of the highs in the S&P. Not for the year, for the highs. I mean,
all time.
Yeah. All-time highs, and we still have, what, 20% unemployment?
Makes sense.
You know, depending on how you calculate it. Yeah. And you have people unemployed, you have small businesses going out of business, but yet we're close to all-time highs. I
yeah, how's that happening?
well, you can thank the good old Federal Reserve for printing money and manipulating behaviors, which is what they do. I mean, I hear this argument all the time. Well, is the Federal Reserve manipulating gold prices? I would say there's not a market on the planet that one central bank or another is not manipulating. And it might not be directly. When people think of manipulation, they're thinking of a few people in the back room, you know, conspiring to move prices one way or the other. I'm not going to suggest that that's the case. I think there's way too many parties involved for that kind of a thinking. But I think it's actually a lot more clear and transparent, the manipulation, because what they're doing is, and this is what happened since 2008, is the Federal Reserve basically goes in and they start buying bonds. And what they're doing right now is very different from 2008. Back then they were buying, you know, treasuries, you know, government securities, things like that. Now they're buying pretty much anything on paper. They're buying high yield bonds, which you want to think about the problems with that, right? A company's going bankrupt and the Federal Reserve goes in and buys the bonds so they don't go bankrupt. Like, you talk about a potential issue. So they're buying everything that's not nailed down. And that's pushing bond prices up and subsequently also pushing equity prices up because they know that there's no risk in the market. So they're effectively creating a moral hazard problem where it doesn't, it basically pays to take risk. So they can take as, so people can take as much risk as they want because they're not in fear that the market's going to go down. You know, it's like investing in a company and knowing that they're never going to go bankrupt. Well, why, how do you price anything anymore?
Yeah,
and that's the real problem. Like, how do you price equities or bonds when the Federal Reserve is not pricing them accurately?
Because there's no risk. Risk is a hallmark of valuation. Once upon a time, companies, when they borrowed funds, it was based upon the perceived risk that the money wouldn't be paid back. Now that risk doesn't exist, or it doesn't exist for the time being, and therefore risk is not priced into the market, and therefore the market can't really perform its vital function of allocation, right?
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next.
Arcana Corporation is on the verge of bringing the world's highest grade silver mine into production. The Revenue Virginius mine in Colorado has proven improbable silver reserves grading nearly 37 ounces per ton silver with an all-in sustaining production cost of only US $8 per ounce of silver. The mine is fully permitted with infrastructure already in place, and the company has announced they plan to commence production in 2020. Achieving successful production usually results in a significant upward share price re-rating on the Lassonde curve. Arcana trades under the ticker AUN in Toronto and AUNFF in New York. To learn more, go to arcana.com. That's A-U-R-C-A-N-A.com.
The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Correct. So if you think about stocks, you know, if a stock is highly risky, then it's going to be priced low in comparison to what it could do. But if a stock is really solid, you take like a, you know, some of the largest companies out there, you know, Amazon, Apple, you know, you look at, you know, J&J, you know, you look at these really large companies, and they get priced really well because the risk is perceived to be lower. So your upside is a lot less because your downside is a lot less. And this is the perception anyway. Yes. You know, I'm not talking specifically about them. But now if you take a bond, it operates in a similar fashion. So if you look at like a bond for like a AAA rated company, and there aren't many of them anymore, but if you look at a bond for a AAA rated company, for a 10-year bond, you might get 0.5% interest. But if you traditionally, if you invested in a bond that was borderline bankrupt, you might be able to get, you know, 7%, 8%, 10%, 12% interest rates, because the theory is you're getting paid for taking more risk, because the risk is you could go bankrupt or you could get 10% a year. So the bonds are priced based on the expectation of what you're getting paid for taking risk. The problem is high yield bonds are generally risky. Historically, there's a 7% default rate. Right now, it's actually much lower than that, but historically, it's closer to 7. So if 7% of the bonds default and you're getting paid 2% interest, that math doesn't work, right? You're getting paid 2% for taking a risk of 7%. You're better off just, you know, buying CDs or treasuries, where there's virtually no risk. I mean, there's always risk, but there's as little risk as possible. So with bonds, what the Fed is actually doing in buying their junk bonds is first of all, they told people they were going to do this. So everyone bought the bonds and pushed the price up, and then the Fed will go in and start buying them. That allows them to spend less money on this. So it's a way of manipulating the system without actually doing anything. But they've gone in apparently and started buying bonds. So now I don't know what high yield bond rates are right now, but they're much lower than they should be. And why would I go in and buy a high yield bond when the rates are really low, when the risk is they could default? Another example of this is Toys R Us. So Toys R Us filed for bankruptcy, I think it was last year or 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And they were on life support as it was. So they were, their bonds were deemed risky, but yet they were trading as if nothing was wrong. They're actually trading at a premium. So you actually were making money for buying this, you know, borderline bankrupt bond. And then overnight they filed for bankruptcy, and then the bonds went down to, you know, close to, it wasn't zero, but they went down like 70% or something like that overnight. So the point is in a normal market, that would be priced appropriately. It wouldn't drop 70% overnight. It would have been close to the mark as it approached bankruptcy. It might have dropped 10% or something, but it should have been trading close to where it would have afterwards. So the problem is there's no price discovery. So how do you know what anything's worth?
Good question. And isn't that the very basic function, the most basic function of a market, Kirk, is to where buyers and sellers and observers go to set prices, to determine values? You know, it sounds like you're kind of hinting at almost an Austrian economist perspective here. And yes, the ultimate indicator of information is price. And when price is distorted, then you really have your information is bad. And then how do you make decisions? I'm not talking just in the market. I'm just talking in business in general. If you think that really the economy should collapse or real estate purchases should go way down, but the government is going to keep mortgage rates at 2.5%, so anybody almost can buy a home, then you're getting a distorted market and you're going to keep building houses, and that might be the wrong thing to be doing.
Right. So you alluded to a really important point, and you know, price discovery is, you know, you and I may disagree on whether this stock market is priced appropriately. You and I can disagree on that. That is what makes a market, right? Is you have buyers and sellers deciding what the appropriate price is. You may say the market should be at 2,800 on the S&P. I might say, well, it should be at 3,000. That's how markets work. We don't have to agree. The more people involved with the transaction, the more accurate the price will be. And the price is what people are willing to pay for it.
Right.
And that is a natural market. That is a free market. We don't have that.
No.
We have, I wouldn't say it's a managed market, although every year we get closer to that. It's not a free market, though. And I think one of the problems is people think we have a free market and they treat it as a free market. And when it doesn't work as a free market, they say, oh, the free market screwed it up. Well, we don't have a free market. Like, we haven't had one for a while. And you could argue whether that's a good or a bad thing. I mean, you could argue that all day. But the reality is we are where we are, and we need to be able to manage the situation that we're in. And right now, the situation that we're in is that the markets are being heavily managed.
Yes.
And, you know, there's no price discovery. And, you know, there's a huge issue with moral hazard. There just is. In the 2008, the banks were the moral hazard problem. Now it's everything. Everything is a moral hazard problem. Stocks, bonds. I mean, other countries were doing this, and now it's in the U.S. So it kind of leads me to believe, like, what's the market value? What's the true value? And do you want to take the risk of the markets dropping 50% and coming to a more normal value? Because that's what price discovery leads to, right? Like,
yeah.
The market dropped 35% because no one had any idea what they should be priced at when the whole world is not working. I'm surprised it didn't go to zero. I mean, quite honestly, yeah. Like, when companies aren't earning money, how do you have earnings, you know? So,
good question.
Yeah, it wouldn't have gone to zero because there's still assets, but still, I mean, get my point is that there's a lot that goes behind this. And you mentioned Austrian economics. I mean, I actually got a degree in economics, and I don't remember taking that class. I don't think it was actually offered.
Yeah,
just for reference.
Definitely not. So we get back to the thing of your podcast. So do what you know, what you understand. But is anything safe now?
Yeah, so I think it's a great question. I'm a big believer in investing in what you know. So the stock market, you know, if you know technology stocks or, you know, a specific company, mm-hmm. great, then you might have an added advantage there, and that's worth investing in. If you are an expert in real estate, then that's what you should invest in, because that's where your best advantage is going to be. You know, I talk about getting an edge in the market. When I say the market, I mean any investments.
Sure.
You know, so getting an edge is really important. If you're a real estate investor, why are you investing in technology stocks? Because they're going up?
Yeah.
I mean, that's not really a good enough reason to do it. I think what I've found in my career, and I've done a lot of different things in my career in this field, is the most successful investments and the ones that I'm the most excited about are the ones that clients bring me and say, hey, I'm an expert in real estate and I want to invest in this property within my retirement account. Can you help me do that? That to me is exciting because I get to participate, you know, vicariously through my client in good investments. And we've seen so many cool and interesting things. I mean, we've seen investors who are investing in irrigation pipe and they're making really good double-digit returns. You know, investors investing in fishing rights, airspace rights, tax liens, legal judgments, private company stock, you know, horses, livestock, farmland. I mean, you name it, we've probably done it. Cryptocurrency, gold, silver, everything. And to me, what's fun is seeing what investors come up with and helping them strategize the best ways to invest in that for, you know, for their best interest. Because for me to come and say, you know, hey, you're making 50% returns on your horse, and yeah, you should come make 5 or 6 in the stock market. To me, that's just... It's just not.
Yeah.
It just doesn't make sense.
All right. Well, I think we got a good idea of your investment philosophy here. It's definitely outside the mainstream. It's not monetizable for the most part by Wall Street, which is probably a good thing, because one thing I've learned about Wall Street is they always come first. Their fees come first. Their profits come first. You come second. Anyways, people want to listen to your podcast. Want to find out more about you? Where should you go?
Yeah. So thanks, Gary. So you can find me. It's a Money Tree Investing Podcast. The URL is moneytreepodcast.com. I host the show. We have a wide variety of guests for all different topics. It's primarily about investing in personal finance related stuff. Probably have a few guests that you guys that I know that you would like, Kerry.
I'm sure.
And yeah, that's the easiest way to find us. It's on Apple, iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, all that.
Great.
So we're easy enough to find.
Excellent. Hey, well, we really do appreciate you coming on. It's been very enlightening and it gives you another aspect, another way to consider the whole investing conundrum. Questions, comments, just write us email address, kl@kerrylutz.com. That's kl@kerrylutz.com. Twitter feed is @KerryLutz, Facebook page, Financial Survival Network, and of course our home site, financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Sign up now and get our free newsletter. Well, Kirk, been a pleasure. Hopefully we'll talk to you again soon. Take care.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Kerry.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.